Jimmy Gretzinger. I work with Michigan Outdoors Television. And tonight, we are here at the River Church. It's putting on a wild game dinner. They've been doing this for years and years. And we're here tonight. Actually, we're here as Michigan Outdoors Television as kind of the main speaker tonight. And so we're going to tell some fun hunting stories. We're going to learn a little bit about our television show. We're going to challenge these guys spiritually just to kind of take the next step in making a relationship with God a little bit more important with them. But these wild game dinners are a great way to reach out to men, have a lot of fun, and raise a little bit of money for a good cause. So we're real excited to be here tonight. Going to say my name again? Being a part of Michigan Outdoors Television, I'm a host on the show. The show's been on the air since the early 1950s, so a long time, and we cover the great state of Michigan, all the different hunting and fishing aspects here in the state of Michigan, and we love doing it.
Hey, I'm Jeff Lane. I'm the development manager for Reaching Higher. I'm here at the Wild Game Dinner for the River, for the Rivermen. And what I do is I raise money for Reaching Higher. And these guys are giving us money from this event, almost 500 people, and we're just honored to be here. Okay. So Reaching Higher is a youth leadership development program. We go into high schools and middle schools during the school day over an 8-week period of time, once a week for 2 hours. It's a transformational program that's just awesome for kids. We're based in Brighton, Michigan, and yet we're growing all over southeastern Michigan. And now we've got some work over in Charlotte. So we're growing, we're in the city of Detroit, we're as far east as Royal Oak and Warren. We're as far south as Saline. So we're all over southeast Michigan.
We're going to officially get things started here.
Reaching Higher has been around since 1997. It was co-founded by Susie Dahlman, our executive director. And she's just an amazing woman who was a school teacher and a sales trainer. She put the two together to form Reaching Higher.
Mr. Mike.
I just want to thank the Rivermen for what they've done for our organization. And this church is an amazing part of the community. Very thankful.
Hi, I'm Jim Needham. I'm at the Wild Game Dinner here as a benefit for the Rivermen. And having a great time tonight. A lot of great food and some chance to win some guns.
Gold Coast.
Go ahead.
I came tonight because I'm a member of the River Church and I'm retired. I love this event. Every year it's growing and growing. And invite all these guys to come on out. All right, the Rivermen basically go out and they fundraise. This is a fundraiser and the funds, I'm not sure this year what they go for. The annual River Game Dinner. And we've got a lot of good prizes, hunting trips, a lot more yet to come tonight.
I'm Chris Lantish, and I am here tonight because I'm supporting the men's ministry at the River Community Church. I am at the Wild Game Dinner, sponsored by the River Community Church. There's a ton of great wild game here. They've got elk, they've got venison, buffalo. What else? Oh, zebra. Zebra, that's a new one for me, so I'm looking forward to trying all that. So far, everything's been fabulous. This is my second time, and I'm hoping for a third time next year.
Hi, I'm Jim Vetter. I'm with the Rivermen Wild Game Dinner. We're out here tonight. We got about 460 people. The event's sold out. We're supporting a great charity. This is Dave Cherry. Dave Cherry's helping out on the committee.
And we're just here tonight to represent the River Community Church and be here for Reaching Higher. And we have a lot of great events going on tonight. We have bucket drops and we have live auction items. We're just excited to be here for a good cause.
Okay.
All right. We want to thank all of our sponsors that we couldn't do it without you. And also Cleary College for having us. Trigicon is our presenting sponsor. And we just really thank them for all the food and everything that they've got for us.
So the Rivermen is the men's group in the River Community Church. We're a very active group, probably different than most churches where the guys just get involved. You know, most churches, the ladies are all involved in a church, and it's not the guys just sit in the background. It's different here. If you notice with all the orange shirts in the room tonight, we're involved and we're active and do things as men for Christ.
Go ahead.
Hi, I'm Greg Williams. I'm the executive pastor of the River Community Church, and this is our 9th annual Wild Game Dinner. And it started several years ago just as an outreach and tried to bring the whole thing of hunting and what people enjoy in this community together and eat some really wild game and some really strange stuff that I've never eaten before, like zebra and things like that. And it's absolutely delicious the way it's made. And as a church, do we just embrace that portion of the county we live in and the community we live in? And it's kind of fun just to bring us all together. And we're building a brand new church. It'll be on M59 and just west of US 23, and it's in Heartland, Michigan. We've been meeting in a high school, but now we're going to have this brand new facility. It'll be a state-of-the-art auditorium with probably the best sound system in the area. And it'll be a place where you can really come and enjoy and hear the gospel.
Okay.
You know, it's been a cool night. We've got over 500 people here tonight, just from all over the community. And this happens because of sponsors like Trigicon and others that just make this event what it is today. And it is kind of cool, too, that we're at the Johnson Center here in Howell, Michigan, with Clare University, beautiful facility, and they have been just so very hospitable to us, and it's just been a great event tonight.
Fun here while everybody's waiting to get their food. Just comments for the kids here. We're gonna have
I'm Payne Peugeot. I'm at the Wild Game Dinner. I won this baby gun. I was really hoping I won it because this is the last one in it.
All right, I'm Jennifer Williamson with Reaching Higher, and I am absolutely impressed with this event. This is my first time here, and I couldn't be more blown away by the attendance, the people, the charity, and I am eternally grateful for everything that the Riverman have done for Reaching Higher. So, thank you so much. Appreciate it. On behalf of Reaching Higher, I would like to thank the Riverman and Clary College and the other sponsors for all that they've done for our organization. Eternally grateful. Thank you.
My name's Harry Riopel, 67 years old. I'm in Brighton, Howell area right now at the Big Game Dinner. I happened to come across the picture of Morton F. in a fishing contest that he sponsored, and I won first place, that he awarded me an original Mickey Mouse watch from 1953. I just thought it'd be great to share it with the rest of the people. I think I might be the first fisherman to ever be awarded a prize by Michigan Outdoors. Maybe not. Have a great day. God bless.
Hey, my name's Terry Prisk, and I'm the lead pastor at the River Community Church, the River on 59, and we're experiencing right now our 9th annual Wild Game Dinner, and I love this thing, and the reason I do is it brings so many different people from the community to a function that they like. Good food, great door prizes, rifles being auctioned off. We've got an incredible speaker this year, Jimmy Gretzinger from Michigan Out of Doors. He's a personal friend. And the reason that we put this entire event on is so that we can connect people with the outdoors, with a great time, and also let people know that, you know what, God can be brought into their venue, God can be brought into their life, and that's not something that's using hunter terminology, squirrelish or something like that. In fact, it's an incredible thing with an incredible impact. We've got some incredible sponsors here. Trigicon, the optic company, helps us out every year. We've got some people, a granite company this year, that said that they wanted to help out. And we've just got some people from the community that have helped out this event in an incredible way. And we actually had to use Clare University because it's really the only venue we can use that can accommodate this kind of a crowd. The River Community Church, or the River on 59 as we call it, actually right now meets in the old Heartland High School, the Performing Arts Center. But 1.2 miles to the west, we're building a whole new campus with a new auditorium, incredible lobby, incredible children's wing, and that's going to be open March 1st of 2015, and we're pretty excited about that. And we're a church that wants to have impact in the community. In fact, we do. We put on a Christmas store every year. This past year, that accommodated over 100 families, over 600 people, to provide Christmas with dignity to people that weren't going to have a real good Christmas. And then we also work with a pantry in Brighton called Bountiful Harvest. And that's an incredible ministry locally in the community. And then we're also involved with a lot of ministries down in the inner city of Detroit that do tutoring, house renovations. And so we don't want to be inward focused. We want to be outward focused. We've got an incredible, incredible crowd here tonight. Just under 500 people. And it's not just men. It's men, women, and children. And they're having a great time. And what we really would like to see happen in people's lives is this, is that they develop mentally, socially, physically, and spiritually. And if they understand that there's a God who loves them, a God who has a purpose and has a purpose for them, you know what? That's a pretty good winning combination, and that's what we want. To be honest, I couldn't think of a better place to serve and to lead. I'm privileged, and I count it a blessing in my own life to be the lead pastor at the River. All these guys who put this on, and look at this crowd that we have today. What an incredible night. Thanks a lot.
The simplest, to motivate young people to live a life, to awaken a life of purpose with passion and confidence. And so what we're trying to do is get in schools. We're in 20 schools right now to change kids' lives. This is one of them. He's going to speak to us in a few minutes. This is Tyler Vedder. He is the man. So it was founded in 1997 by Susie Nauman in Brighton, Michigan. And it's a nonprofit leadership development program. And we meet twice. We meet once a week for 2 hours during school day for 8 weeks. Ninth week, we do a little celebration called graduation. It's made up of 25 students, two instructors that we provide, and five mentors. And what we need are some men to mentor these kids in these schools, middle schools and high schools. We've served a lot of kids, a lot of programs. The cost of a program to serve 25 kids is $5,000. So we increase self-awareness and self-confidence through public speaking. Our kids that go through the program don't even realize they're in a public speaking course until it's over and they realize they did it every week for 8 weeks, and now they're comfortable speaking about themselves. There's a lot of peer mentoring that's going on there. Ultimately, we give attention. When you give attention, you make a connection. You make a connection, you can make a correction. And that's when kids know that they're a miracle from God and what they're here to do. So we provide the power of hope and skills to cope. So what do our graduates think about us? This chart shows you simply the kids are changing. They come out of there with greater self-confidence. And without self-confidence, you got nothing. If you don't believe you can do math, you can't do math. If you can believe you can speak in front of 400 people or 500 people, you can probably do math. Parents love us. Parents come to our graduations and they fill out these forms for us. They're blown away by it. As you can see, it's an increase of 43 percentage points from before and after in their kids' lives, in the parents' opinions. This is a slide that shows what the parents are actually saying in their comments. Number one thing they see out of the kids, greater confidence, greater self-esteem, better grades, better attitude towards themselves and others. We have a superintendent here in Howell, Ron Wilson, who's donated one of the live auction events items tonight. He believes for the cost of the program is probably the most effective program he's seen in his 30 years. And we're honored to say that he just joined our board of directors last fall. He came to us to join, and we're honored to have him on the team. So we're booming. This chart shows just the sheer number of classes that we're doing, the number of kids we're affecting, over 750 kids a year now. So thanks to programs like this and RiverMed, we're going to be able to affect more lives. This is an example of how we're going to replicate our model. Here in Howell, we have a superintendent that cares about us. And my job is to go out and raise the money. We get the funders and the superintendent, then we can bring the instructors in, we can bring the guidance counselors in, and then together we find the mentors. Tonight I'm looking for mentors. In the back, we've got a sign-up sheet. Fill it out, get it back to us any way you want to. We're definitely looking for mentors, like I mentioned. So these are some of the school districts we serve. We go as far east as Warren, as far south as Saline, as far west as Charlotte right now. We're growing. We're looking to go into more schools. Tyler Vetter just graduated from our program last fall at Howell High School. He's a 16-year-old young man. He's in charge of videotaping this event tonight, right? And he's agreed to come speak about his Reaching Higher experience.
Yeah.
Come on. Give him a hand. Not only graduated the program, at the end of it, he got a camera and he started interviewing people for us. We put it up on our Facebook page. He's put it up on the Riverman's Facebook page. It's pretty awesome. So, Tyler, what do you want to say to these folks about Reaching Higher experience?
Well, the experience is just kind of a way for 25 to 30 kids to get together and just boost their confidence. Like, school find, like the counselors will find people that have like low confidence or that have been dropping out of classes because they don't like doing the work because they're not motivated to do it. What this program does is it finds a way to motivate you to succeed. And I was one of those kids that just hates school and tries to drop out every class. And now because of Reaching Higher, I am graduating a year early from high school. So, just can't thank Jeff Lane enough for him and his program and all the things that they're doing in the schools.
Thank you, Tyler. What about Tampa Club? We want to thank the Rivermen again. Again, we have a booth in the back with information. We'd love to talk to you. Rivermen, Steve, thank you so much. James Vetter, thank you very much. All right.
How's everybody doing tonight? Good. Can we give a round of applause for whoever cooked all that food? That was so. And I was here, how many years have you guys been doing this center now? 9 years. So one of the first couple of years I was here. And so if you were here back then, was anybody here back 9 years ago? Oh, a few of you. Okay, you might hear some of the same stories tonight. But I feel very fortunate to be here tonight to get to talk with you. I feel very fortunate to have the job that I do with Michigan Out of Doors Television. If you're not familiar with Michigan Out of Doors Television, we are primarily a hunting and fishing show, probably 80% hunting and fishing. That was not a firearm. Thank you very much. And so we get to travel all over the state of Michigan. And one thing kind of different about Michigan Out of Doors is that we do 52 episodes a year. Most of the other outdoor shows around the country do 13. There's a few that do 26. We're crazy enough to try to do 52. And we travel all over the state of Michigan, from the west end of the Upper Peninsula, all the way down to Detroit River, and everywhere in between. People tell me all the time, like, Jim, you have got the best job that there is. And I'm like, well, you don't know about the pressure and the time and trying to get something every week. And then I start thinking about it, and it's like, you know, I might actually have the best job that there is, you know? We love what we do. We get to tell your story. I think Michigan Out of Doors has worked for so many years because it's not about Jimmy Gretzinger, it's not about Jenny Olson, our co-host on the show. It's really about you. It's about the sportsmen and women of Michigan. And so I think that's why it's worked for so many years, and we're very fortunate to have the jobs that we do. Can anybody tell me who the first host of Michigan Outdoors was?
Morton
Neff. That's right. Actually, I saw a Morton Neff picture here tonight. And who took over after Mort? Jerry Gepetta. Yeah, somebody said that over there. Jerry had the show for a couple years, and then who took over after Jerry? I heard his name out there.
Fred Trost.
Fred Trost had the show Michigan Outdoors for 20-some years. He ran into a little legal difficulty, would be the best way to say that, kind of late 80s, early 90s, lost the show, and at that point, the Michigan United Conservation Club, or MUCC, bought that name, Michigan Outdoors, and restarted it with Bob Gardner as the host back in 1993. I came along in 1998 as kind of the low man on the totem pole. 2001, took over as executive producer. And then at the beginning of 2009, I actually purchased the show from MUCC, so we're kind of doing it privately owned again, and we have a lot of fun. We get to travel around the state, and one of the questions I get pretty frequently is, hey, what are some great stories you've been on, or what's some of your favorite stories that have, you know, that you've got to go on and all these adventures around the state, and they kind of change from year to year, but I'm just going to tell you a couple hunting stories that stick out over the last couple years. This one was from last year, youth hunt, deer season. Not this one, but the one before. I had my, at that point, 9-year-old son in the blind with a buddy of mine, and he had his 9-year-old son. And we're over in West Michigan, where I live, and it was an evening hunt, and so we had the, you know, the little guys right in front of us in the box blind, and we said, okay, if a deer comes from this side, my son Charlie was going to get to shoot first, and if it came from the other side, my buddy's son was going to get to shoot first. And so we're sitting there, sure enough, here comes this doe. She's working out, and there's some standing corn, and we could kind of see her in the corn for probably about a half hour. So the kids were really, had a chance to kind of get worked up, and then they kind of had a chance to kind of settle down a little bit. Well, this doe comes out, gives us a good shot. Now, we're hunting with a muzzleloader, and really the effective range for what we were doing was about 50 yards, and this deer came out just about right there. And so, deer steps out, my son Charlie, he's getting ready to take the shot, and I said, okay, when you're ready, go ahead and fire. Bam! And that's what happened. and so the smoke goes over, the muzzleloader, smoke goes, we can't see, deer goes running off. And so we're, you know, I'm watching, I got the camera going, so I'm videotaping all this and watching it. Deer runs off and stands there, and it's looking pretty fine at that point. So now it's at about 100 yards, and so my buddy's son, he's got his gun out there, he's like, okay, go ahead and take a shot. Bam! And so I got the camera over there, and I got it all on the frame. And probably about 2 feet behind the deer, and about 3 or 4 feet in front of the deer, you see the ground just go, this big, you know, where he hit with the bullet. And he turns to his dad, so I still had it on the deer, so you can see it hit the ground, deer runs out of the screen, and this little guy turns to his dad, he's like, Dad, I got him right behind the shoulder, right in the lungs. And he goes, no, son, you hit the dirt. And he goes, well, I might have done that too. He said, so, and then I, you know, I panned the camera over to my son, Charlie, and I was like, were you shaking? And he's like, yeah. So those kind of stories, that one stuck out because it was just such a, and you know, we didn't get a deer on that hunt, and I had more people tell me how much they enjoyed that hunt because of just the interaction in the blind. And so that story sticks out. That's one that stuck out. Who here has done any bear hunting? Or any bear hunters out there? A couple here. Anybody done it with dogs before? A couple, okay. Well, we were doing a story a few years ago on how to train bear dogs. And we were up in the Upper Peninsula, and it was August, I believe. August, September, was before the actual hunting season. So up there with probably 7 or 8 families, a bunch of kids running around, and we were camping up in the UP for 3 or 4 days. And so I went up there, and to hunt bear with dogs, you actually put a dog on the front of your truck, on the hood of your truck. And they have a little lead down to where they're kind of leashed onto there. Now, if you have a new truck, you have a spare hood. Most of these guys have old beater trucks, and so they just put them right there on the hood. So you have one dog up there called the strike dog, and then you have a bunch of more dogs in the back of the truck. The rest of, you know, when you start running them, so you can get them out and everything else. But the way you hunt them and how we were going to train these guys is you just cruise around the back roads of the Upper Peninsula, wherever you're going to be hunting. And you wait for the strike dog to smell a bear. And if a bear has crossed that road within the last 12 to 15 hours, amazingly enough, those dogs can smell it. So we're just cruising along, and you never know when it's gonna happen, so we're just putzing along, and suddenly just brrr, you know, the first dog goes, and then all the other dogs go, and it's just awesome. It's the sound is something else. So we get out, sure enough, there's the track, you know, boom, 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 we throw a couple dogs down, off they go. And so we were gonna, you know, we had all these trucks and families around, and so our plan was to, you know, kind of coordinate where everybody's going to be, and then we were all going to try to converge on if we could get a bear up a tree. And so they take off, and so we worry, you know, we get ready, okay, we just got one going, and then so-and-so is over here, and they're talking, they're like, oh yeah, I hear them, they're heading west, and then somebody else, another part of the woods, oh, they just went north, they're going north, it's just fun and exciting. And so sure enough, once they get a bear up a tree, their barking kind of localizes, sounds a little different. And so that had happened, and so we were the closest truck to that, to where they had the bear tree. And so we were gonna go in there, get some video, we're gonna bring everybody in, take pictures, and then we would all pull out, the bear comes down and goes on about its business, because it wasn't the hunting season yet. Just training dogs. And so we get in there to the tree, and sure enough, here's this beautiful Michigan black bear up tree. Now I'm getting some video of it, and the dogs are all there. And what they would normally do is tie off the dogs. So they'd get a leash around them, get them tied to a tree, so everybody's just kinda knows where everybody is, and there's no excitement or whatever if the bear comes down. So we hadn't done that quite yet, and so they had put some younger dogs down as they were training these younger dogs to come in on the scent trail. And I guess they're supposed to come in quiet, or mean not barking. And I never heard this. They explained what happened to me afterwards, because what had happened is these dogs came in, as they got pretty close to the tree, they started barking. What happened was these dogs here heard the barking that I never heard, and I guess what they thought was, hey, we've caught this one. Somebody's got one over here. Let's all go over there. And so all the dogs were gone. And I thought, huh, I wonder what that's going to do to them. And I looked up, and all I said was, here he comes! Because he was coming down right now. And this, if you've ever seen a bear go up and down a tree, they can fly up and down a tree. So he's coming down the tree. I start backing up, and I'm videotaping this bear coming down. And John, the guy that we were with, well, he didn't want this bear to come down that tree. So he whips off one of his dog leashes, and he's yelling at this bear, and it's coming down. He starts hitting the tree with the leash, yelling at the bear. The bear's coming down, chomping his jaws, making all sorts of noise. It gets lower and lower and lower, and his leash is down here, and then it was up here, and the bear's low enough where he's actually hitting the bear in the butt with the dog leash. And I'm videotaping this thinking, I can never show this to anybody. I can't put this on TV. And this bear is going to jump on his head, and I was certain that I was going to see this thing just attack him. So I'm backing up, hitting trees, videotaping this, and he's hitting the bear. Now the dogs hear all this, so now all the dogs come back in. They're going crazy. The bear's right there. It was just chaotic. And so finally the bear is like, all right, I had enough of this. So he just kind of eases back up the tree, sits on a limb. And we were able to get everybody in, take their pictures and everything. But I'll never forget, John standing there, bear goes back up, and he turns to me and he goes, boy, that was a close one, he said. That story sticks out.
Right here. Ladies and gentlemen, right here. This is that nice Tragicon 3 Acupoint 3.9 by 40 scope right here. Variable power dual illuminated rifle scope right there. Now take a look right there. It's got that illuminated triangle tip. It's got the unique design for this super quick target acquisition in any light conditions right here. It doesn't require the battery. It's got the super nice scope right here. There's one with the privilege of the second one is what we have right here. So a high bidder will give you a choice. You got two scopes, two rifles you want to scope up. You can have the second one. And if you want to just say two times, it'll be twice the price, of course. But you can get the second one as well. All right? So high bidder right here. Go right here. We'll get the opportunity for one or two. It want to give $1,000 on them. Here we go. $1,000 to start on. Hey, you better want to make it $1,000 for them. Hey, you want to get them on. Make it $1,000. You can want to get $500. Go. Who can buy a bit of the $500? You can buy them, make it $500. You can buy them, fine. And get three down, make it $300. I'm up to 50 better three, gonna be $300. Yep. I'm up to 50 better $300. I'm up to 50 better three, down, make it $300. Where? I'm up to 50 better three. You get 275. I'm up to 50 to 75. You need 275? I'm up to 275. Not 300. Make it three down, make it $300 on them. I'm up to 275, get $300, 300, not quarter. Yep. Three, you better quarter, three and a quarter, 300, not quarter. Where? Yep. Three, you better quarter. Hands here now, 3 1/4, you're taking a 325. I'm 300 and a quarter, quarter, 3 1/4, 3 1/4, I'm making 325. Where? I'm at 300 mil, 3 1/4, get your hands here. I'll get about a 600, 600, now 7, which is 700, 800. And give me about $800, gonna be 800 here. I'm at 7, it's about a 750. I'm at 7, 7 1/2, I'm at 7, 7 1/2. You're out the back, 7 1/2. I'm at 700 over here in the red, 7 1/2. I'm at 700, give 7 1/4, and 725. I'm at 700, quarter there. 7's about a quarter, quarter, 7 1/4. 7's about a quarter, I'm at 725. I'm at 7, 7 1/4. 7's about a quarter, but I'm at 7 1/4, get forward. Into 7 1/4, I'm at 700, 725, negative 7 1/4 here. I'm at 700, 7 1/4, I'm negative 725, I'm at 7 1/4, anybody else? 725. $700 your way over here, $700 right over there. Does he want one or does he want two? He's gonna take one. You were the second highest bidder right here. Would you like to go to the same price?
Trevor.
Okay. Would your bidder like in on the owner back there?
Two.
What?
He's going to take two?
Two.
He's got two. They're gone. Thank you very much. Let's give him another nice round of applause.
Well, I bought the scope because it's a great value. And I could use a new scope. But second of all, I mean, there's a great mission going on here tonight. So I support everything that is going on here tonight, especially. I love the story. Don Tanner from Brighton. Really enjoyed it.
I'm from Brighton, Michigan. My name's Larry. The Goble family invited my son and I to attend the event. It's a great event. Really love coming. 2 years in a row we've been here. I bought this awesome Chichikov scope because it's a great, I've used them before, and it's just a great piece. I mean, there is no better than a Chichikov. And it's a great price. My buddy Don bought one. I don't want him having a nicer scope than I have.
All right. Kyle Mattingly. I'm a guest of Kurt Collins, who goes to the River Church, and I had an excellent time here tonight at the Wild Game Dinner. I was a little intrigued about the zebra. I really enjoyed the zebra steak. It's the first time for that, so that was really quite good. Yeah, it was an awesome time. I had a blast, and I can't wait for next year.